console, and you can use those commands, and ultimately you can make a programming of the robotic arm. It is very, very easy to do that. But once you are an engineer who is designing the path of the robotic arm, then you must be aware about the kinematics and dynamics of the robotic arm. So with that, I'm going to discuss about the kinematic model. But first of all, I just want to let you know means how the robotic arm moves over a particular path. Suppose you have a triangle, right? And you want your robotic arm to move over that triangle, right? So what you will do, suppose there are 3 points, 1, 2, and 3 in a triangle, then the end effector of the robotic arm, say it's a pointer, I'm just assuming that it's a pointer or it's a welding gun, then what you will do, you will manually move the robotic arm to point A, and you will touch the robotic arm's end pointer to the point A, and you will ask, you will just need to put one or two things in your console. You will simply say, remember this point as point A. Once you feed that point as A, then the coordinates of that particular point has already been memorized by the robotic arm. So whenever in any program you will call a point A, then robotic arm will automatically move to that particular point. Then what you will do, you will manually move the robotic arm to point B. Then you will manually move the robotic arm to point C. So once you have teach the robotic arm all the 3 points, then in the robotic programming, what you will do, you will put a line command that the robotic arm should move from point A to B following a line. Line is the shortest distance between point A and B. Then from B to C, then C to A. So once your program is done, it's that much easy. It's that much easy. Once this program is being done, then whenever you save that program as triangle program, so whenever you will be calling that program, the robotic arm will move to the 3 points A, B, and C. This is how the programming is being done by the end user in a company. Now, I'm telling you that the coordinates will be memorized by the robotic arm, but it's not that much easy. There is a lot of work by the engineers to make the robotic understand how those coordinates are identified. Because the robotic arm, only the base, which is the 0-0 position, and any robotic arm, the base is only known to the robotic arm. The rest of the links and joints are not known to it. So what you need to do, you need to use the transformation matrices to transfer your coordinate from the base to the end effector. So how you can do that? So if you have done this transformation matrices in your CAD CAM, then you must be aware that there are two kind of transformation matrices. One is the linear transformation matrices. Another one is the revolutory or rotational matrices. So from going from base to the end effector, there are two things which are there important. One is you are transferring the coordinate system from one point to another point. That can be a linear transformation. And at the same time, there can be an angular transformation. That is a two coordinate system. That is, one coordinate is say at point A dash, and one coordinate is at point A. So you need to see what is the distance between the two points and how they are orient among themselves with each other in the coordinate system. So once you are able to know the angle and the linear transformation, then by using those transformation matrices, you can transform your coordinate from the base to the next available joint. By following that transformation, you can move from zero to the final point. Okay. just hold on. Hello. Sorry for interruption. Actually, I got some urgent call. So what I was telling you that, and we need to transfer the points from one and two to the next, right? So how to do that and how to go about this kinematics? We'll be starting with that. First of all, likewise, I just want to know where is my hand. So if suppose there is a robot and I just want to know where is my hand, then I need to transfer the coordinate associated with the hand as compared to the brain. So only then my brain will be able to understand where my hand is. So I need a direct kinematics over here. An objective is to drive a method to compute the position and orientation of the manipulator's end effector relative to the base of the manipulator as a function of the joint variable. I know there might be this definition is not that much clear to you, but once we are going through this PPT, you will be able to understand each and everything. So right now, the main thing that is taken from this objective is that we want to compute the position and orientation. Kiski end effector ki. Kiske with respect to base ki. Theek hai? Base of the manipulator as a function of what? The joint variables. Okay. So we want to know the position and orientation with respect to the base. And between that, there can be numerous links and joints. So we need to see how to take up the transformation matrices and how to know the orientation and position of each individual link and joint with respect to the previous one. Okay, so that is our aim. So when we talk about degree of freedom, it's independent positions, different ways in which a robot arm can move, and we'll talk about joints. So if I'm talking about degree of freedom of a rigid body in a plane, we see there are 3 degrees of freedom. If I'm talking about in a space, there are 6 degrees of freedom. Okay, so we have this much degree of freedom. Then we have 6 degrees of freedom, out of which 3 are positional and 3 are orientational. So in a robotics, degree of freedom is a number of independently driven joints. So as degree of freedom increases, the positioning accuracy definitely decreases because you will be having more joints and more links. When we talk about more joints and more links, that means there will be more losses in terms of friction or anything. Okay, then this will also increase the computational complexity. The cost will increase, the flexibility will increase, but the power transmission will also be more difficult to take care of. So this is about the degree of freedom. Then we have robot links and joints. There are joints we have, there are end effectors we have. So joints, you can see a manipulator may be thought of as a set of bodies connected in a chain by joints. So as per number of degree of freedom you have, accordingly you have number of joints with you. Okay. So in this, if I'm talking about, if I just ask a question from you, how many degree of freedom my hand has? If I say this, I'm talking about my hand, how many degree of freedom it has? So just go through that and check it. You have 27 degree of freedom in your hand, right? So you can check that later on once this lecture is over, because your finger has one finger has total 3 degrees of freedom in the positional and 1 degree of freedom as a rotational. So accordingly, you can check how many degree of freedom the total hand has. So when I'm talking about robot joints can be of two type. One is revolute joint, where you can see in the first figure. In this figure, you can see that there are only angles involved. That means they are only rotating with respect to each other. Right. And then we have a prismatic joint. In prismatic joint, there is only a linear motion involved over here. So we have two kinds of joints in robot. One is revolute joint, another one is a prismatic joint. Then we have a Puma 560. The Puma 560 has 6 revolute joints. A revolute joint has 1 degree of freedom that is defined by its angle. Okay, so we'll be later on, once we went through all the analysis, DH parameter and everything, I'll tell you ultimately our aim is to do analysis for Puma 560. We'll take up this as a challenge in the last. So next we move to the kinematic functions of a link. The kinematic functions of a link is to maintain a fixed relationship between the two joint axes it supports. This relationship can be described with two parameters, the link length A, the link twist angle alpha. Okay, so we have divided the kinematic functions into two. One is link, another one is a joint. So we'll be having two parameters associated with a link and two parameters associated with the joint. Okay, so first of all, I will be considering the parameter which is associated with a link. You can see over here, right? If I move from this link, this joint axis, to this joint axis, the total distance, the perpendicular distance that I have to move from this point to this point is known as AI minus 1, this one. This is known as a link length. So if I'm talking about the parameter associated with a link, then one is the link length. And how to measure the link length? It is the perpendicular distance between the two joint axes, the joint axis I minus 1 and the joint axis I. So whatever is the distance between them is AI minus 1. So that is known as a link length. So if I'm talking about the rotation, what you need to do, you need to move one axis over to the next. So if this is axis I minus 1, if I move this axis I to this place, like over here. Okay, so this axis is nothing but axis I. So axis I or axis I minus 1, in dono ke beech mein jo angle aayega, wo kya aayega? Alpha I minus 1 aayega. Theek hai? To mere paas do parameters hain. I have got two parameters over here. One is the link length, another one is the twist angle alpha. And how to measure that? I told you. The link length alpha is the perpendicular distance between the two joint axes. And what is angle alpha? It is the angle between the two joint axes, the axis I minus 1 and axis I. So these are the two parameters which are associated with the link. Why I'm putting so much time, stress over here? Because once you are able to know how to measure what is the direction in which they should be measured, then you will be in a position to make your final matrix, and from that matrix you will be able to make your transformation matrices, and that will tell you how to define the position and orientation of end effector with respect to the base. So these are the small things which we should understand, and then only we'll be able to make our final matrix. So this is the same thing which has been discussed in the previous slide. So we are calculating angle alpha minus 1 and link length AI minus 1. So next we'll talk about joint parameters. So there were two parameters associated with a link. Now we have two parameters which are associated with the joint. So in the joint parameter, the relative position of two links is known as link offset. Link offset is known as by the parameter dn, which is the distance between the links, the displacement along the joint axis between the links. Ye kya hota hai? We'll show you in the next slide. And the next is the joint angle between the two, between the normals, is measured in a plane normal to the joint axis. So iske saath, in joint axis, we have got two parameters associated. One is known as the link offset. Another one is known as the joint angle theta. So you can see over here. So this is your axis I minus 1. Okay. This is the axis I minus 1. This is the axis I. And this is the link length AI minus 1. Okay. And this is the twist angle alpha I minus 1. What you need to know now is the joint parameters. So in joint parameters, you can see that the origin for this joint I minus 1 is happened to be over here at this point. And the origin for this particular joint axis is can be represented over here. Now the distance between the two, what you need to do is you need to move your x-axis over here, and distance between the two x-axis is known as a d. So you have got our xi in this direction. This is your xi, this one. This one is known as xi. Okay, and this is the direction in which xi minus 1 is there. So this is your xi minus 1, which you can have. And this is your x. Then the distance between the two is known as a offset. Offset between the two joints. And that is represented by a distance d. Similarly, you can check the twist angle. एक सिंपल सी बात आपको याद रखनी है कि जब आप लिंक की बात करोगे, लिंक पैरामीटर्स की बात करोगे, तो आपको जो भी मेजर करना है वो अबाउट जेड एक्सिस मेजर करना है, ठीक है? सो इफ यू आर मेजरिंग अ लिंक लेंथ, इट इज मेजर्ड अबाउट जेड एक्सिस. इफ यू आर मेजरिंग द ट्विस्ट एंगल, इट इज मेजर्ड अबाउट जेड एक्सिस. व्हाट इज जेड एक्सिस? दिस इज योर जेड एक्सिस, दिस वन. ओके, सो वंस यू आर मेजरिंग द पैरामीटर्स ऑफ ज्वाइंट, then you will be measuring along x-axis. Likewise, over here, I am measuring the angle between the two x-axis. That angle is coming out to be theta I. So this is my one of the joint parameters. Another one is that the offset, that is the linear distance between the two joint axis, along the x-axis. So that is known as a d over here. So two joint parameters will be measured along x-axis. Two link parameters will be measured along the z-axis, the conjunctive z-axis. So link parameter, an is the length of the link, alpha n is the twist angle between the joint axis. Similarly, we have joint parameter, which is theta n, the angle between the links, and dn is the distance between the links. So now we have link connections. For revolute joints, a, alpha, and d are all fixed. Then theta I is the joint variable. ओके, अब रेवोल्यूट में क्या होगा कि जो ए है, ए तो लिंक लेंथ है, लिंक लेंथ तो हमेशा फिक्स रहेगी, इट विल ऑलवेज बी फिक्स्ड, इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू चेंज बिकॉज द लिंक इज अ रिजिड मेंबर ऑफ द रोबोटिक आर्म, इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू चेंज. सो लिंक लेंथ विल ऑलवेज बी रिमेनिंग कॉन्स्टेंट. अल्फा कैन चेंज डेफिनेटली बिकॉज दैट इज द डिपेंड्स अपॉन हाउ द टू ज्वाइंट एक्सिस आर, टू जेड एक्सिस आर रिलेटिव रिलेटेड टू ईच अदर, एंड डी इज द ऑफसेट बिटवीन द टू ज्वाइंट एक्सिस. सो इफ दी ऑल दीज आर फिक्स्ड एंड ओनली थीटा इज द वेरिएबल, देन वी से अवर ज्वाइंट्स आर रेवोल्यूटरी ज्वाइंट्स. सिमिलरली व्हाट इज हैपनिंग विद द प्रिज्मेटिक ज्वाइंट्स, वी हैव ए, अल्फा एंड थीटा, दे विल बी रिमेनिंग कॉन्स्टेंट एंड ओनली मूवमेंट विल बी हैपनिंग अलॉन्ग डी, दैट इज माई ज्वाइंट वेरिएबल. So in prismatic, my d will be variable. In revolute, my theta will be variable. So that is, you need to know this. Okay. So if joint axis, these are some of the special cases. Jo, if you can automatically consider these like joint axis z I minus 1 and z I intersect. If the two axes are intersecting each other, then parameter a I would be zero automatically. If the two axes are aligned with each other, they are at the same origin, then a I is automatically zero. If the common perpendicular to z I minus 1 and z I intersect, z I minus 1 at the origin of frame, then d I minus 1 is 0. That means there is no offset between the two joints. Similarly, if joint axis z I minus 1 and z I are parallel, obviously, then there won't be any twist angle between them. Twist angle to tabhi hota hai na, jab aap do z axis ko ek dusre ke saath align karne ki koshish karte ho, unke beech ka jo angle hota hai, wo, that is your twist angle. So if the two axes are parallel to each other, that means there is no angle between them. So automatically your twist angle will be zero in that case. Next we have affixing frames to links, right? So z axis is coincident with the joint axis, I already told you in the previous slide. I already marked what is z axis. Z axis is the axis about which your revolution is happening. Simple, jiske about aapka joint revolute kar raha hai, rotate kar raha hai, usko hum z axis maan ke chalte hain, theek hai? The origin of frame is located where AI perpendicular intersects the joint I axis. अब origin कहाँ से होता है जो पिछली slide में आपको बताया था? That is the where AI perpendicular intersects the joint I axis. There would be the origin. The x axis, just remind make this understandable to you. The x axis points along AI, that is along the link length from I to I plus 1. If AI is 0, then XI is perpendicular to axis I and I plus 1. AI agar 0 hai, to automatically dono link aapke coincide ho jayenge aur XI jo hai, that will be perpendicular to axis I and I plus 1. And Y axis is formed by right hand rule. So you have defined Z axis. X axis is always along the link length. Z axis is the axis about which revolution is happening. And the remaining axis only left is Y axis. The y axis is always formed by right hand rule. वो आपको बता देगा. ठीक है? अब ये हमने एक joint लिया, तो आपका जो revolution है यहाँ पे वो इसके about हो रहा है. तो यहाँ पे ये आपका क्या हो गया? Fix हो गया. ये मेरा z n minus one है, जो कि यहाँ पे show किया हुआ है. ठीक है? How to decide your x n minus one? It is along the link length. Link length क्या थी? I already told you. This is a perpendicular distance between the two Z axis. So that is always fixed. If two Z axis are at some angle to each other, then there will be only one perpendicular. And that perpendicular will be AN minus one. And along that perpendicular, you will be having your X marked over here, which is XN minus one. So once your Z is fixed, XN minus is fixed. Now you use right hand thumb rule. Automatically your YN minus one will be fixed as well. Similarly, you can have your offset, which is dn. So this is the offset between the two x axis, and that is measured along x axis, and this is your parameter for z, parameter for joint axis. Similarly, you can mark your directions for z, x and y for the other two joints as well. So reference vector z of a link frame is always on a joint axis. The parameter di is algebraic and may be negative. Di is algebraic and may be negative. It is constant if joint I is revolute, and variable when joint I is prismatic. That should be clear to you. Okay. The parameter Ai is always constant. The parameter di is algebraic and may be negative. It is constant if joint I is revolute and variable when joint I is prismatic. The parameter ai is always constant and will always be remaining positive. Ai is always chosen positive with the smallest possible magnitude. So di aapka negative bhi ho sakta hai, positive bhi ho sakta hai, but ai obviously link length hai, rigid hai, that is always constant rahega, chahe revolutory joint hai, chahe prismatic joint hai hamare paas. So now this is how the things can be understood if we know what can be constant and what can be variable. Now we come to the transformation matrices. So you can see that if suppose I have six joints with me in a robotic arm which has 6 degree of freedom in a space, then I need to have six transformation matrices, one transformation matrices for each joint. So what I need to do is I need to move from base to the first joint. When I'm moving from base to the first joint, I need to see what is my revolution and what is how much is my linear distance that has been moved from one point to the next joint. So I need to place a transformation matrices from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 6. And multiplying all these matrices will give me the final position and orientation of the end effector with respect to the base. I hope things are clear till now. So for our calculation of this kinematics, there comes a Danawit-Hartenberg, which is in short is known as DH parameters. So DH parameters are universally adopted. Now softwares have also come which automatically calculate your DH parameters for you. and there is a bond graph is also there, which will be very, very helpful. Suppose you have 10 links and joined, it becomes very difficult to put it on paper, draw transformation matrices and all. But if you have a software or you know the bond graphs, then it becomes very, very easy. So the appeal of the DH representation lies in its algorithmic approach. So I'll move to the next slide. You will be able to know. This is the same thing. We have xi minus 1, which is having angle alpha I minus 1. You have link length ai minus 1. You have joint parameter theta I, and there is offset di. So we have got four parameters. Two are with link, two are with joint. So all four parameters are shown over here. I again reminding you that the link parameters are measured along z-axis, and the joint parameters are measured along x-axis. Okay. So this slide itself is very, very important slide. This is going to tell you the same thing which I was telling you that. So AI is the parameter associated with a link. So the distance from ZI to ZI plus 1, it is measured along XI. Okay, I told you ki kis tarah se isko measure karna, distance from ZI to ZI plus 1 measured along XI. Similarly, alpha I is the angle between ZI and ZI plus 1 measured along XI. DI is the distance from XI minus 1 to XI measured along ZI. Similarly, theta is the angle between XI minus 1 to XI measured along ZI. You can also see over here, agar main DI ko measure kar raha hun, to DI kya hai? It is the distance between XI minus 1 and XI plus 1. In dono ke beech ka jo linear distance hai, usko hum kya mark kar diya hai? DI. Similarly, agar mujhe inke beech ka angle karna hai, to automatically main ek z-axis ko dusre z-axis pe move kar dunga, unke beech ka angle check kar lunga, alpha I aa jayega. राइट तो इसी तरह से मैं मेरे चारों के चारों पैरामीटर्स जो हैं वो कैलकुलेट हो जाएंगे मेरे पास. जस्ट गिव मी वन मिनट. So we'll be start at base and assign frames 1 to n. If we have 6 degree of freedom, we will be assigning frames to 1 to 6. Pick x-axis and origin and apply y-axis as a right-hand thumb rule. And consider 3 cases. One is not coplanar, parallel, and intersect. We will see that. So the first case that we'll be having is the not coplanar, which is a general case. So you have two axes, zi minus 1 and zi. Both are not coplanar. So definitely there must be some angle between the two z-axis, and two z-axis are some distance apart. So there will be a common normal between zi minus 1 and zi. So that is known as the link length, and your xi is fixed along this link length. So automatically you can define your y-axis once your xi is defined. Next we have zi and zi minus 1 are parallel. जब ये दोनों पैरेलल हो जाते हैं देन देयर विल बी न्यूमरस नॉर्मल्स बिटवीन द टू एक्स टू जेड एक्सेस. यू कैन चूज एनी वन ऑफ दैट एंड अकॉर्डिंगली यू कैन डिफाइन योर एक्स एक्सेस. वंस दे आर ऑर्थोगोनल टू ईच अदर देन यू कैन फाइंड योर एक्स एक्सेस बाय यूजिंग अ क्रॉस प्रोडक्ट दैट विल गिव यू द डायरेक्शन वेयर योर एक्स एक्सेस वुड बी. जेड आई माइनस वन क्रॉस विद जेड आई दैट विल गिव यू द डायरेक्शन फॉर एक्स आई. Next is origin non-coplanar Z. Over here again, I think it is already been discussed. So next we have DH convention y-axis. How to put that? You can use your right hand thumb rule. So you move your fingers from ZI to XI, then thumb will give you the direction of YI. So this is how you can define your frame. This is how your frame has been assigned to a particular z-axis. Similarly, we have for a parallel already y-axis has been you already have mentioned that xi will be any normal between zi minus because it two axes are parallel to each other. So accordingly, again by using a right-hand thumb rule, you can move your zi to xi, and thumb will give you a direction of y. Similarly, yes. Now we move to the translational along the initial z-axis. Yes. So if suppose I just want to move my coordinate from one system, one joint to the another system, another joint, then what I need to do is I need to go for a translational along the initial z-axis by d. A rotation about the initial z-axis by theta, a translational along the new x-axis by a, and a rotation about the new x-axis by alpha. So यहाँ पे हमने क्या किया? We have taken all the four parameters. अब ये it's not necessary that all these four parameters have some value. Might be out of these four, three are zero. Only one value is there. But we have considered a general case where we are translating our z-axis by a distance d, rotating about an angle theta, translating along the link length a, and rotating about twist angle alpha. So we need to consider these four parameters. Once we are done with these four parameters, then we will be able to move our one frame to the next joint. Right? So this is how the transformation is happening from I minus 1 to I following a transformation matrix. Now this transformation matrices will have four matrices which need to be multiplied. Why four? Because there will be one matrices where you will be translating along z-axis by d. There will be one matrices where you will be rotating. One matrices where will be moving along a, and then one will be along rotation. So after multiplying all these four matrices, you will be transforming your frame from one point to another point, and there will be one concluding transformation matrices. So you can see all those over here. So first is about rotation about theta. So once I'm talking about rotation about theta, so this is the formula. If you know the transformation matrix cos theta I minus sine theta cos theta I. So what is the thumb rule how to write this transformation matrices? If you're rotating about z-axis, then this is important, this thing. What you will do, you will keep one over the way about which you are rotating. If you suppose I'm rotating about x-axis, तो आपका जो first है वो क्या हो जाएगा? One हो जाएगा यहाँ पे, ठीक है? आप क्योंकि z-axis के about कर रहे हो तो ये one हो जाएगा, और बाकी जो आपके चार element बचे हैं, remaining element, you will be writing as cos theta minus sine theta cos theta. बाकी आइडेंटिटी मैट्रिक्स के लिए 001 001 आपको यहाँ पे लगा देना है. सिमिलरली जब आप ट्रांसलेट कर रहे हो अबाउट जेड एक्सिस, तो आपको लास्ट वाले में जाना है, और आपका ये एक्स वाई और ये जेड है. जेड में आप क्या कर रहे हो? ट्रांसलेट कर रहे हो. कितना कर रहे हो? डी आई. आपने ट्रांसलेट कर दिया तो आपको बाकी चीजें करने की कोई जरूरत नहीं है. सिमिलरली फिर आप क्या कर रहे हो? ट्रांसलेट कर रहे हो ए के अबाउट, तो वो यहाँ पे आ गया आपका, ठीक है? क्योंकि एक्स एक्सिस के अबाउट कर रहे थे तो आपने एक्स वाली जगह पे उसको एआई कर दिया। सिमिलरली जब आप रोटेट कर रहे हो अबाउट एक्स एक्सिस, तो आपको याद है मैंने अभी बताया कि जेड में हमने ये वाला पॉइंट पकड़ के वन करना है, एक्स में आपको ये वाला पॉइंट वन कर देना, और बाकी जो ये रिमेनिंग चार एलिमेंट है मेरे इसको इसको छोड़ देना है, और जो ये चार एलिमेंट है मेरे इसको मैं कॉस थीटा माइनस इन द साइन थीटा कॉस थीटा कर दूंगा। ये जस्ट मैं आपकी नॉलेज के लिए बता रहा हूँ, बट आई नो दैट यू ऑलरेडी हैव गोन थ्रू दिस ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन मैट्रिसेस इन योर कैड कैम सिलेबस व्हाइल यू आर डूइंग बीटेक, so this must be understood to all of you. So after multiplying all these four matrices, so this is my final matrices. If I am directly able to know my alpha, theta, d, a, I can put all those values directly over here, and I'll be able to transform my frame from one axis, one joint to another. So this is the final matrices matrix jo, which is needed to transform one frame to another. So what we are doing now, we are considering one example which is known as academic manipulator. Academic, why I'm calling it as academic, because in real sense it is not existing, I'm just taking it as an example. So we have got three revolutory joints over here, which you can see joint 1, joint 2 and joint 3. All these three joints are revolutory joints. Joint 1 is rotating about this axis, only the direction is already mentioned over to you. This is how it is rotating, this is how this is rotating, and this is how this is rotating. So you can imagine, and the distance between joint 1 and joint 2 is R, distance between joint 2 and joint 3 is L1, and joint 3 to end effector is L2. So you know distances, you know the joints are revolutory joints. So ZI is the axis of actuation for joint I plus 1 about which your rotation is happening. Z0 and Z1 are not coplanar. You can see that Z0 and Z1, they are not coplanar, and Z1 and Z2, they are parallel to each other. You can easily see that. So these two joints are parallel, while Z0 and Z1 are not coplanar to each other. Already we have considered the cases for non-coplanar and as well as for the parallel cases. So Z0 and Z1 are not coplanar. X0 is a common normal. You already know ki when the two Z axes are not coplanar, to unke beech ka jo common normal hai, wo link length deta hai. और सेकेंडली उसी के अलॉन्ग हमारा एक्स एक्सिस होता है। सो एक्स एक्सिस हमें मिल गया एक्स नॉट, विच इज द कॉमन नॉर्मल बिटवीन जेड नॉट एंड जेड वन। ओके, सो दैट हैज बीन डिफाइंड। नाउ बिटवीन जेड वन एंड जेड टू बोथ आर पैरेलल, सो एक्स वन कैन बी सिलेक्टेड एज कॉमन नॉर्मल दैट लाइज अलॉन्ग द सेंटर ऑफ द लिंक, बिकॉज देर विल बी न्यूमरस पैरेलल लिंक्स बिटवीन द टू। ओके, सिमिलरली द थर्ड एक्सिस कैन बी देयर, so shown with joints in a non-zero positions. So you can easily see that the theta angle exists between the two joint axes. Okay, so we have got joint Z0 and we have defined a direction for X0, Z0 and Z1. You can see that there is an angle between X1 and X0. So this is your angle theta 1. कौन सी है? नहीं नहीं अब डाला है ना, डाला ये जाएगा मंजू मैडम के पास, इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स में वो नोटिस सेंड कर। वैसे वो मैडम यहीं पे आ रही है अभी 1:30 पे, तब करवा लेंगे उससे। Okay, so you can see the angles between X0 and X1. This angle is theta 1. Similarly, between X1 and X2, you see the angle is theta 2. Similarly, between X2 and X3, there is an angle theta 3. Because you need not to worry about ki ye theta 1, theta 2, theta 3 kahan se aage. Whenever you have a revolutory joints, aapka wo jo theta hai, wo to definitely there will be some angle theta to rahega hi rahega. To aapko usko likhne ki zarurat nahi hai. You can straight away put theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. If suppose I have 6 joints and all are revolutory, definitely I can immediately write down theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, theta 4, theta 5, theta 6. In that case, I need to concern about ki mere paas X1 link length kya hai, alpha angle kya hai, aur mera D offset kitna hai. So that is the things need to be calculated for revolutory joint. Theta will be there. Wo to yahan pe aapko dikha diya, but otherwise there is no need to even see that. Now, I need to see alpha 1. Now you can easily see that Z0 and Z1 इनके बीच में what is the angle between these two? It is a 90 degree angle. So alpha 1 will be equal to 90 degree, rotate by 90 degree around x0 to align z0 and z1. So immediately I'll be able to know that ये आपने align कर दिया इस तरह move करके इसको. तो ये जो angle निकल के आया मेरे पास, this is nothing but angle alpha 1. Now this is the DH parameter final situation or state. I have got three link with me, link 1, 2 and 3. I told you if the links are variable, revolutionary, then theta 1, theta 2, theta 3 would be there. So straight away I can put theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. Now what about D? Offset kuch nazar nahi aa raha because all the axes are lying along the same line. So mera paas koi offset nahi hai, 0, 0, 0. What about alpha? Alpha, there is only one alpha that is between Z0 and Z1, that is my 90 degree. Z1 and Z2 are parallel, Z2 and Z3 are parallel, so there will be 0, 0. What about link length? Already I told you, Z0 and Z1, the link length is R, Z1 and Z2, L1, Z2 and Z3, there is a L2. So once your this information is collected, now it becomes very easy to write down your transformation matrix. Okay, so this is the straight way the final matrix has been taken, where this matrix is taken from the all the four multiplications of the individual matrices. So ab aapko kya karna hai? You have got all the information over here. You have got cos theta ones. So everything is there. You can directly put those values and you can see the Naveen Ekman Basun. So we have got these four different matrices, and you can see according to the previous discussion, you can put all those values over here, and finally you will be able to calculate the final matrix, right? About this manipulator. How to do the calculation? All you can practice at home. So next is about a particular example has been taken for the same problem. So values have been given over here. You can use those values and you can calculate the transformation matrix. Now I go to say Puma. This is somewhat complicated. So I just walk you through this Puma 560. but if you just try to move along with me, I hope you'll be able to understand. I'll try my best to make you understand the things, but once you know the you are able to do some few of the exercises with the easy problems, then it will be more you will be in a better position to understand this Puma 560. But I will try to make you understand how this Puma 560 things have been calculated for DH parameters, and once you are able to write down that columns for DH parameters, then it will be easy for you to make the transformation matrices. So this is a kind of a 6 degree of freedom problem. So once you are able to understand its DH parameter, then you can write DH parameters for any problem, because this is a 6 degree of freedom, because right now we have 6 degree of freedom robotic arm most of the time. So let me see, how can I make it bigger? I hope this is visible to all of you. I don't know, means how to make my screen bigger.
Sir, no issue. Participants can maximize their screen, sir. You may continue, sir.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
All right. Just give me 1 minute. So what we have a base over here. We have a base over here. This is the base, which is fixed. And this is our first link. Then this is the joint, first joint, second joint. Then you have your link over here. Then this is another link, link two. Then this is a link three. And then there is a movement like this over here. All right, so this is going to move like this. And below that, we have got this as the link, and this can be moved like this. And then we have our joints, final gripper. So this can also be moved like this. So I'll show you once you move through this. So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is the 4. You can see that this is the fourth link joint, this one. So this is the fourth one is moving like this. This is the fourth. Okay. Then there's a fifth. Fifth is moving like this. I hope you can see that. This is a fifth. Then sixth is again rotating. So this is rotating like this. So we have fourth, which is rotating about the vertical axis. Fifth is moving like this. And sixth is, you can see, because this is the only complicated thing over here. Fourth, fifth, and sixth. You can imagine this thing like, I have three revolutory joints with me. Let this is my Z axis. This is my x-axis, this is y-axis. So if I'm talking about, I have three axes. So just imagine 4, 5, and 6. These are doing nothing, but one is the revolution about z-axis. Another is the link 4. Link 4 is rotating about z-axis. Link 5 is rotating about x-axis. And link 6 is rotating about y-axis. So these three revolutions are happening at the end, from 4 to 5 to 6. You can imagine that 4 is rotating about z-axis, link 5 is rotating about x-axis like this, and your link 6 is rotating about y-axis, about this. Okay, so this is how your revolutions are happening. Okay, so now but about z-axis, how to place the z-axis, that's another important thing. If I'm talking about this fixed axis, okay, this is 0 and this is your first joint. So because there is no movement between the two, so that means Z1 and Z0 both will be in the same direction. Because कोई movement ही नहीं हो रही है तो मैं उसको एक ही direction में लेके चलता हूँ. But about my Z2, this one. This is something rotating like this. Okay? So if it's rotating like this, then my Z2 would be in this direction. Similarly, what about Z3? Z3 is moving like this. So this is the axis about which this movement is happening. अगर ये मेरा Z3 है, तो ये वाला जो मेरा axis है, वो इस तरह से move करेगा, इस तरह से. ठीक है? तो ये movement किसके about हो रही है? Z3 के. तो ये मेरा Z3 fix हो गया. Similarly, Z4 मैंने आपको बताया था, ये Z axis के about 4 move कर रहा है, तो उसको मैंने नीचे show कर दिया Z4 में. Similarly, मेरे पास Z5 है. Z5 मेरा किसकी तरफ आ गया? X axis की तरफ. मतलब लिखूंगा मैं उसे Z, वो मैं आपको शो करने के लिए बता दिया एक्स वाई जेड किस तरह से ओरिएंटेड है. उसी तरह से मेरा जो सिक्स है वो नीचे की तरफ ओरिएंटेड है, और सेवन मुझे क्यों यूज करना पड़ रहा है वो मैं लेटर ऑन आपको बताता हूँ. आई विल टेल यू. ओके, तो सो दिस इज क्लियरली मेंशन ओवर दिस स्लाइड एज वेल. जेड एक्सिस मीन्स लिंक फोर इज रोटेटिंग अबाउट दिस. Y axis means link 5 is rotating about this, and X axis link 6 is rotating about this. So choose a coordinate axis. मैंने choose किये 0, 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. ये मेरे coordinate axis हैं. Now angle between X0 and X1, ये मैंने कैसे choose किया? देखो Z1 and Z0 मेरा इस तरफ हो गया. Z2, Z3, Z4, Z5, 6 मैंने आपको सारे बता दिए किस तरह से oriented हैं ये. Alright, and now I need to place X0 and X1. Okay. So X0 and X1, because X0 and X1 both are fixed to each other, so they are not moving. So any direction I can assign the X0. So this is the direction where X0 has been assigned, and similarly X1 is also aligned along the same direction. Whereas X2, X2 will be from Z2 to Z3. I told you this is a link length from Z2 to Z3. This is a common normal, and along that my X2 would be there. So X2 is defined over here, but otherwise how X1 and X2 are defined? Because Z1 and Z2 both are fixed, so they will be having along the same direction. So that's why any arbitrary direction that is X0 has been chosen over here. And from Z1 to Z2, Z1 to Z2, because this is orthogonal. So once is Z1 and Z2 is orthogonal, I told you I need to take a cross product to define the direction of X1. So from there I got the direction of X1, and from the link length I got the direction X2. So all these X0, X1 and X2, all these are acting along the same direction, but they are having some offset between them. I'll tell you. So X0 and X1, X0 and X1, there will be some angle because this is a revolutory joint. I told you whenever there is a revolutory joint, there will be some angle between them. So that angle over here is theta 1. And X1 and X2, the angle will be theta 2. And X2 and X3, this angle will be theta 3. So whenever you are measuring angle, you are measuring it from Z2 to Z3. Similarly, XI, XI is measured along angle between, this measure is from ZI to ZI plus 1. Okay. So similarly, distance between X2 and X3. Distance between X2 and X3, because there is some offset. देखो ये वाला जो है वो joint यहाँ पे है और ये वाला मेरा joint यहाँ पे है. So this X2 is along this direction, this X3 is along this direction, this direction. So the distance between X2 and X3 is the offset, and that offset can be termed as D3. So D3 is measured between X2 and X3. Similarly, distance. Now I need to find out alphas. So how to calculate alpha? Alpha is measured from ZI minus 1 to ZI along XI minus 1. So if I talk about Z1 and Z0, my alpha will be 0 because both the axes are acting along the same line. Then if I'm talking about Z1 and Z2, okay? So Z1 and Z2, then this will be a 90 degree angle. Okay, so if I take a cross product from Z1 to Z2, my X axis would be going inside the paper. But what direction I have shown over here? I have shown a direction in this direction. Okay, so that means my 90 degree angle would be opposite to the previous one. Okay, so if the angle is 90 degree, but in the table I will be showing it as a minus pi by 2. Why? Because Z1 and Z2 cross product will give me a thumb which is moving inside the paper, which will be moving inside the paper. And so I need to take a negative pi by 2 over here. Similarly, if I'm talking about 3, in 3 it is 0. Okay. Why it is 0? Because Z2 and Z3 both are parallel to each other. So there won't be any twist angle between them. Similarly, if I move from Z3 to Z4, you can see that because Z3 and Z4 both are perpendicular to each other. So again, if I move from Z3 to Z4, my X4 should be going inside the paper. What direction I have taken over here? I have taken in the opposite direction. So that definitely this 4 will again be minus pi by 2. Similarly, if I move from 4 to 5, then because it is in the same direction, it is taken as plus pi by 2. Similarly, for 6, it is taken as minus pi by 2. So these are my alphas. If I talk about my link length for a 1 to 2, because the axes are coinciding, it will be 0. 2, again, it will be 0. But from 2 to 3, there will be link length alpha A2. And from 3 to 4, there will be link length A3. But other 5 and 6 are both are at the same point, so there will be 0. Similarly, DI, already I told you how to calculate D3 and D4. I already told you. Other Ds will be 0. Similarly, theta would always be there because this all the joints are revolutory joints. So that is theta 1 to theta 6, the angle would be there. So this is how this DH parameter table has been created. Okay. So once you have created the DH parameter table, now you need to make 6 transformation matrices. 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 6. So accordingly, all transformation matrices would be over here, and all the values already have been calculated in DH table. So you can replace those values over here, and yeah, then you can multiply, and then you can calculate your final figure. All right. So with that, I will share this PPT with all of you. You can do these calculations at home. So with that, I'm just closing this lecture. I hope you are able to understand the DH parameter. That is the main concern, because later on, once you will be able to know the dynamics, it will be very easy to write down those equations for you.
Sir, hello.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, I want to know that from a previous sessions, we are studying that Kuka like robots. So Puma 560 is also like that Kuka, sir?
It's like means Kuka is nothing but a manufacturer. Okay.
Yeah.
If I'm talking about Kuka, then basic thing you need to know about is the degree of freedom. So if there is a Kuka robot which has 2 degree of freedom, there is a Kuka robot which has 6 degree of freedom. Likewise, in our university, we have 6 degree of freedom Kuka robot with us. So if I'm talking about that 6 degree of freedom, then that is equivalent to Puma 560 if all the joints are revolutory joints. We are not talking about who is the manufacturer. We are talking about if there is a 6 degree of freedom and all the joints are revolutory joints, which is similar to Puma, then you can write down the things like this. If there are some prismatic joints and there is some revolutory joints, then you can write down your DH parameters according to that. So it's not about who is the manufacturer.
Yeah, okay, thank you
so much.
So participants, if you have any questions, you can ask. You can use your chat box also. We can see the questions and sir will answer that. So thank you so much, sir. I have observed that there is no questions. So thank you for your knowledgeable session, sir.
Thank you, Vinesh. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So thank you, participant, for joining in.